Good morning. Happy Easter. Thank you for being a part of our worship service. It's wonderful always to be together, to lift up the Lord, to praise God for what He's done for us, to remember Jesus' sacrifice and His resurrection. We try to do that every Sunday, but especially this Sunday as we celebrate Easter together, we'll celebrate Jesus' resurrection. Thank you for being a part of this service, for joining us, whether at 9:30 Sunday morning, later in the day, later in the week. We're so happy to have you a part of this service. Let's lift up our voices, lift up our hearts to the Lord as we sing praises to Him, as we pray together, as we share in communion, as we share in Scripture together. Christ is risen, and the church throughout the centuries has responded, He is risen indeed. Let's worship God together.
Bring forth
Our reading this morning is from the 16th chapter of Mark, verses 1 through 8. Mark 16, 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they may go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You're looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He is risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he's going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid.
Christ the Lord is risen today.
Earlier this week, or sometime last week, I got something in the mail from the AARP, the American Association of Retired People, or something like that. It was a solicitation, an ad that said, "Welcome to the 50s Club. If I joined AARP, I'd get some kind of organizer set." Wow. Quite a reward for acknowledging that time is ticking and that I'm at the age where I guess I'm supposed to be excited about an organizer set. I'm not intending to retire in the near future. Old preachers don't retire anyway. They just say in conclusion and then ramble on for another decade or two. I'd prefer to think I have another 35 years or more to live. Still, let's call that AARP solicitation what it is. It's a sign that I'm going to die. Without being too morbid, let's just acknowledge for a moment that the signs of death are all around us. This week we learned that more Americans died in 2020 than in any previous year in our history. That's no big surprise, I suppose. COVID-19 ended the year as the third leading cause of death in America. As we gather together this Easter, we do so with the signs of death all around us. If you're at church in person, you're wearing them on your faces, probably. The way we're sitting, the distance we're keeping, It's all testimony to the power of death, to the reality of death. Like Jesus at Lazarus' tomb, the signs of death are all around us. The mourning, the fear, the whispers, the lowered voices, the sealed cave. Sometimes the signs of death around us are clustered around neighborhoods and countries and locations specifically. They menace particular people more than others. Just this week in Chicago, we heard about Adam Toledo, a 13-year-old, killed in Little Village in the middle of the night in some sort of confrontation with police. A tragedy, no matter what happened. You understand why Jesus wept at his friend's tomb, don't you? It's also heartbreaking. It's no wonder that we try to ignore or rationalize the signs of death. Try to force them to make some kind of sense in our minds. And it's no wonder that everybody thought Jesus was crazy for wanting to open Lazarus' tomb. By this time, there's a bad smell, they told him. I'm sure with lowered voices. Yeah, I mean, literally and metaphorically, death stinks. We'd rather ignore the signs if we can. I mean, it's nice of AARP to try to make me think I'm just joining some kind of exclusive club instead of just getting older. It's nice to picture a retirement full of travel and exciting experiences, being one of those cool older guys you see on the commercials who surfs and does yoga and walks on the beach with his wife, but the reality is that no matter that however many waves you surf, one of them is going to be your last. But we don't like that reality, and so we try to keep death walled off if we can. I think that's what some of us were doing as this pandemic started, just trying to keep death walled off. It's not so bad. It's no worse than the flu. Let's open up. Let's not tank the economy. We were saying that almost hopefully. Maybe this won't be as bad as we think. It was whistling past the graveyard. Just another way to try to keep death at arm's length. Behind walls and stones and vaults and neatly trimmed grass. But Jesus insists on opening the tomb. Smell the stench. See the body. Acknowledge the signs of death. Didn't have to do it that way, I suppose. Could have not let Lazarus die at all. Could have raised him from a distance long before the funeral and the burial and all of that. But he mourns with us. And he makes us see and smell death. And only then does he raise the dead. This Easter, let's not pretend that death doesn't exist. Let's not try to ignore it or wall it off. Let's acknowledge the signs of it. It's okay to mourn. It's okay to grieve. It's okay to be afraid. And then let's worship when Jesus does something about it. Because surrounded by signs of death, what else are we to do but look to Jesus for signs of life? Death is real, and it walks in our world. But Jesus is also real, and he also walks in our world. In Acts chapter 10, verses 36 and following, the apostle Peter has been sent to this Gentile, Cornelius, to tell him about Jesus. And as he gathers there in the house with Cornelius and his household, he says, "You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what's happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John preached. You know. This isn't something the apostles spun out of thin air. It was not debatable that Jesus announced peace or that he went around doing good and healing. And there were different interpretations of those events, for sure. Not everyone agreed as to what they meant, but that they happened, there was no debate. Just a few years at most before Peter told Cornelius what those things that had happened meant. And this is, by the way, what Christianity is built on, the historical reality of Jesus. What he taught and did was known, even by non-Jews like Cornelius and his family. Maybe we don't appreciate that properly. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they gather in their documents stories about what Jesus did and said and about what those things meant that his followers had preached and maybe even written down. They preserve at least four distinct sources, at least. There's at least one source Mark got his information from. Matthew and Luke used Mark, but each have their own stuff too, some of which agrees with each other, some of which doesn't. That's at least two more sources. John's doing his own thing. Seems to preserve at least one other source. You can tell that some of those sources at least were oral, just stories related from person to person. You see that little glimpses of that, like in the Aramaic words that are sprinkled through the Gospels. Abba, Talitha Kum, Eli, Eli, Lama Sabachthani. People were telling other people about Jesus and what he did and said, and even speaking the words, repeating the words he spoke in Aramaic. And they were doing that long before there was a document called a gospel. This is what Peter means when he says, you know. As Paul will later say in Acts, these things weren't done in a corner. They were done out in the open. It was no secret. But the message is more than he existed. He taught. He healed. He was crucified. It's even more than that he was raised from the dead. The message of Peter and of the church through the centuries has always been that these things that happened mean something. Jesus and his resurrection are the signs of life that we're looking for. Peter reminds Cornelius of the good news of peace that God sent through Jesus. That comes from the Old Testament, actually. You've probably heard the Hebrew word shalom. You probably even know that it often means peace and that it's used in much the same way as Hawaiians use aloha for hello, for goodbye, for best wishes, for everything in between. That's because shalom is probably best defined as prosperity and security. Shalom is a state of being in which you don't have to worry or be anxious or afraid. The Old Testament writers, especially the prophets, used it often to describe the time of the Messiah when everything would be set right. There would finally be justice and righteousness. The faithful would prosper and be secure, while the wicked would receive the consequences of their actions. It's sort of the Hakuna Matata of the Bible. It means no worries for the rest of your days. So when Peter talks about the good news, the gospel of peace through Jesus, he doesn't just mean peace with God through forgiveness of sins, though that's obviously the first worry that needs to be dealt with. The gospel is that God does offer forgiveness of sins, and then so much more. The prophet Nahum will give you an example. Look, there on the mountains, the feet of one who brings good news, who proclaims peace. Celebrate your festivals, Judah, and fulfill your vows. No more will the wicked invade you. They will be completely destroyed. the peace that Nahum envisioned, the peace that God would bring through his Messiah. That peace would bring celebration and stability. There'd be no fear of wicked enemies threatening their well-being. The Lord of all, Peter says, has come bringing peace. And Peter's one of those messengers running to tell the good news. Peace is kind of the first thing to go, isn't it? Those signs of death start making themselves evident. And we start to lose hope. We get worried. We get fearful. We get anxious. Our worlds kind of close in on themselves. It's understandable that peace might be in kind of short supply this Easter. Our second Easter in this upended world that we're living in. So let's take a moment to reorient ourselves. I read a few years ago that some school systems in the United States are changing the world maps that they're using in classrooms. See, maps are an attempt to project land masses off of a three-dimensional globe onto a two-dimensional page in a textbook or to hang on a wall. In the process, some distortion is inevitable. The old school maps are based on a projection that was mainly interested in trade routes between Europe and the New World. And so countries that aren't in those latitudes kind of come out distorted. Like, for example, South America in reality is nearly twice the size of Europe, though the old maps make them look similar in size. Africa is 14 times larger than Greenland, though, again, the old maps make them look the same size. Alaska is much smaller in relation to Mexico and Germany than the old maps show. Antarctica isn't nearly as large. What Peter's doing in this sermon to Cornelius and what he's doing for us is he's inviting us to redraw our maps. God marked Jesus out as his deliverer, Peter says, by anointing him. That's what you did when you made someone a king. But God anointed Jesus with the Holy Spirit and power. And Jesus went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil. If peace is the first thing to go, it's also what Jesus came to restore. If God's inclined to heal you, there's peace in that. If God's willing to act for good in the world, there's peace in that. Jesus, Peter says, went around. I like that phrase. Jesus went around. Peter and others saw him and interacted with him at a particular time and place. They watched him do good and heal. They heard him teach. He came right into our world with all of its signs of death. And he started bringing life. When he healed a leper or gave sight to the blind or fed the hungry, he was barging into Satan's basement and freeing all the people that he had chained to the radiator. He was saying, this isn't the way God wants things. And he's doing something about it. At Lazarus' tomb, he wasn't saying that no one's ever going to die again. He was saying that death doesn't choke out life. Not when God is going around doing good and healing all who are under the devil's power. And he is. He is. In Christ, God is going around and he's doing good. He He's demonstrating that all of us who think from time to time that the devil might be about to win one, we're just so wrong. Sure, of course, the devil has his signs of death, and they're scary. They can be terrifying. Unless you know someone whose power is greater and who is inclined to do good and to heal. Don't ever imagine, whatever happens to you, whatever happens in your world, don't ever imagine that God wants anything other than to do good to you and to heal you. That's the gospel. That's the good news of peace. That's what he showed us in Jesus. Predictably, it made folks mad. And so Peter acknowledges what everyone else knows about Jesus too. They killed him by hanging him on a cross. Actually, what he says is they killed him by hanging him on a tree. The book of Deuteronomy uses that phrase. It says that someone hung on a tree was under God's curse. Peter had to have picked that turn of phrase intentionally. Jewish people would have seen crucifixion in that light. The person who hung there was cursed. And so, for that matter, was the community for allowing him to remain there exposed after his death. So crucifixion was sort of the ultimate sign of death in the Roman Empire. Crosses today mean something different. But back then, the cross was the ultimate sign of death. Who knows how many crosses would have been visible to those going to and from Jerusalem with dead and dying people exposed to ridicule and the elements and God's curse. And that's how Jesus died. Peter admits it. He recognizes it. That's how his way of life, that's how his work of doing good and healing and rescuing those who were enslaved by Satan ended with him suffocating and bleeding on a cross. So they took this good man, the leaders of the nation. They took this good man and they killed him in this awful way. This ultimate sign of death cast its long shadow over his life. But, Peter says, but God. You could do a pretty long sermon series with that title, but God. Maybe I will. But God remembered. But God said. But God sent. But God did not. You get the point. There are lots of times in the Bible where things look bad, but God acts to change the outcome. The gospel, though, is about God acting to change all the outcomes. But God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. In case you didn't know it, that's kind of the high point of Peter's sermon. Think about it for a minute. Isn't it just like God to take this ultimate sign of death and turn it into the ultimate sign of life? See, this is the thing about Christianity. There's a lot of important stuff in Christianity, don't get me wrong, but this is the thing. If God raised Jesus from the dead, everything has changed. If he didn't, nothing has changed. And nothing will change. The New Testament writers put way more emphasis on the resurrection than they do even the cross. The idea is that by putting our faith in Jesus, we share in his resurrection. We haven't exactly figured that out, how that happens, what the exchange actually is. Paul even says in one of his letters, somehow we'll attain to the resurrection from the dead. But the point is that we do share in Jesus' resurrection. His empty tomb means everything for us as well. Why be afraid of death? We'll live again as surely as Jesus did. Why live our lives ignoring and denying the signs of death around us? The sooner we embrace the idea that life here is temporary, the sooner that we can recognize how valuable it is, how much our limited time matters. The sooner we can tell other people about the hope we have in Jesus. The sooner we can change our maps. My little advertisement from the AARP doesn't just tell me I'm getting closer to my death, but also that in Jesus, I'm getting closer to my resurrection. It reminds me that I still have some work to do in this life that he's given me. So what do? When we're so overwhelmed by the signs of death around us that we don't even want to get up in the morning, we look again at Jesus' empty tomb, that ultimate sign of life. Sure, signs of death are all around us. Sometimes it even looks like death wins. But God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. There were witnesses. They had lunch with him. They walked and they talked with him. Everything changed for them when they understood that the world's signs of death were now overshadowed by God's sign of life, that empty tomb. Everything changed when they knew that they had a purpose. Go tell people. Go tell people that Jesus is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The church has sometimes mutated God's judgment into some sort of a sinners in the hands of an angry God nightmare. But that isn't what Peter means here. He's emphasizing that in raising Jesus, God shows that death doesn't put us out of his hands. Jesus and his resurrection demand a decision on our part. The signs of death are still all around us, and we can live our lives as though they have the final say. Or we can look to him. We can see the ultimate sign of life in his empty tomb. He's given us a new map to live by. In his name, through his death and resurrection, God offers forgiveness of sins. The old signs of death don't have to apply anymore. Jesus, the one who went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, the one who died and was raised, is the one who will finally judge all the living and the dead. And his decision will be life for everyone who puts their faith in him. So, this Easter, let's not be taken in by the signs of death around us. Let's not live our lives like our highest value is ignoring and denying those signs as long as we can. Live your life from here on out with the empty tomb, God's final word on death, his emphatic sign of life. Live your life with the empty tomb guiding you, reassuring you, comforting you, giving you hope. Friend's father-in-law died this week, and my friend texted these words to me: "No more pain." That's learning to live with the empty tomb as your guide. I know parents who gather at the graves of their children every Easter to anticipate that joyous resurrection. That's learning to live by the new map of the empty tomb. It doesn't erase the signs of death in their worlds, but it elevates and glorifies the sign of life. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
Good morning, family. Wish we could be together today. But as we gather around the communion table, we gather as a community, a family. We are honoring the sacrifice that Jesus gifted to us. Jesus directed us to do this whenever we gather together in his name. We do this weekly, though on this day, Easter, the world reflects on the wonder of our Savior's death and rebirth into a world not worthy of such a gift. For we are sinful creatures, even the best that have ever lived. We are lacking in so many ways and are capable of so many actions that can negatively impact our brothers and sisters and ourselves. If we look at ourselves honestly We can see daily where we fall short in the eyes of God. We can struggle over and over again with the same issues, even though we want to stop, we desire to stop. And we can beat ourselves up over our shortcomings, get ourselves down, feel totally lost and undeserving. We can feel as if we've abandoned our best friend. Even those closest to Jesus left him to suffer alone on the cross to protect themselves, afraid of being shamed, future retribution, punishment, or even death from those that represented the status quo at the time, basically everyone else. Well, I have often found myself on the outside looking in, being left out, bereft of inclusion, but on hindsight, happy that what I missed out on was something that I did not want to be a part of my life. But I do tell you that you are the creation of the one God. He made you. He loves you. He blesses you. He challenges you. He forgives you. You are a unique being created with a purpose. The soul that is in you is so precious that God sacrificed his only son that you might live in him, knowing that you will never be perfect. As the hymn says, God is the potter and we are the clay. So know always that Jesus rose from the dead for us, mankind. What a wonderful gift of hope. In thinking about this, I found the second chapter of Ephesians, and I'll close with that. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh, following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And now we'll have the prayer for the bread that represents the body of Christ, the life that he so willingly gave up. But he gave us so much more. He gave us knowledge. He gave us example to love one another, to help one another. And also for the cup, for his blood that he gave up, he easily shed in love for us so that we might have a place with him. Bow with me. Our most heavenly Father, we come before you, sinners, repenting, asking for your forgiveness, thanking you for your grace. We ask that you always be with us through our journey. Help us to continue to make you the focus, not only for our own lives, but in helping others. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings you've given us, the family that you've given us, our friends, the food on our table. But we thank you most of all for your Son, who shed his blood and died on the cross for us. We ask that you bless this cup and this bread that represent his body and his blood. And we do so in his name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thanks again for being a part of this service. Your participation, your presence here with us means a lot. To know that we're worshiping together, to know that we're lifting up our voices together, to know that we're sharing in this celebration of Jesus' resurrection is such an encouragement and such a blessing. And your part of it is absolutely vital. So thanks for being a part of this. Just a few announcements. And we'll have a prayer together, and after one more song, we'll be dismissed. Hope you have a very blessed Easter Sunday. Enjoy being with those you can be with and finding ways to connect with those who we're still not able to be present with, perhaps. But let's spend some time today celebrating what God has given us in Jesus, celebrating the people that are a part of our lives, and celebrating the great blessings and the many, many forms that His grace takes in our lives. You should have received a newsletter, an email from us. If you haven't already and you'd like one, let us know. We'll be glad to send that to you. You can connect with us online, connect with us over the phone, and we'd be glad to share that with you. We have several that are on our prayer list that we need to be lifting up to the Lord. We have some grieving loss who we need to lift up to the Lord. So in a moment, we'll pray and ask God's blessings on those who are in special ways in need of His grace. There is a dining room set available from a member of our congregation. If that can help you in some way, contact us. Let us know. We'd be glad to share that with you. Thank you for those who have volunteered to help in our food pantry. Very grateful for you. You've made a huge difference, and we appreciate your continued support and continued participation in that effort as we try to continue to share the love of Jesus through feeding families who are food insecure during this difficult time. So thanks so much for the way that you've shared in that. We appreciate it. If you have not already, follow us on Twitter. Follow us on Facebook, subscribe to our YouTube channel. We'd love to connect with you in those ways as well. We have some great content going out pretty much every day on Facebook and Twitter, and we'd love to have you share in that and be a part of that network. And please do share our links with your family, with your friends who may be looking for online content in some way, looking to worship together. Please feel free to share those links with those you love. Let's bow together in prayer. We're thankful, Father, for your grace, for your love. We're thankful for the empty tomb. We're thankful for the resurrection. We're thankful for the hope that we have because of Jesus. And we pray that we'll live as people who have hope, not defeated, never despairing, never broken or crushed. Always, Father, fixing our eyes on Jesus, on His suffering, on His death, and on His resurrection. Knowing, Father, that we share in the power of His Spirit. Knowing that we share in your love and grace. Father, we pray for the many on our prayer list, for Evelyn, for Rowan, for Suzanne, for Joey, for Kent, for Linda, for Pat, for Aisha, for Paul, for Denise, for Marge, for Patty, for Sean, for Pat, for Monica, for Lizzie, for many others, Father, whose names are on our hearts and on our minds. We lift them up to you. We ask for your grace. We ask for your healing. We ask for courage. We ask for strength. We ask for hope. And we thank you, Father, for those who are celebrating recovery and celebrating the end of treatment and celebrating a hopeful mindset about their situations. Father, we thank you for your answered prayers, for the ways that you help us carry our burdens, for the ways that you come through for us faithfully again and again. We pray for Celeste and for others who are grieving loss, who are mourning loved ones who are missing from their lives now. We pray, Father, for your comfort and for your peace. We pray for the comfort of the gospel, the comfort of an empty tomb, a resurrection. Father, we pray that you'll help us to live in our world with its signs of death as those who point to the tomb as your sign of life. And help us to go about in our world, Father, freeing people from Satan, freeing people from their fear and their anxiety, offering them the peace of the gospel, letting them hear and see and experience the love of God, your love, through Jesus. And we pray in his name. Amen.
We will see the holy city come descending like a bride, with the Lamb of glory seated on his throne. A new earth and a new heaven with its gates thrown open wide, when the King of Zion comes to claim his own. Till your kingdom comes in power, saints and angels shout amen. Father, we will be your kingdom until then. Then the sun will raise a scepter filled with righteousness and peace, saying there is no more sorrow, no more night, and the chains will all be broken, no more hunger, no disease, only freedom when the darkness turns to light. Till your kingdom testify for you. We will share